The objective of this video is to introduce the rectifier and inverter circuit topology and review our status on the course learning outcomes. So you've just taken the midterm exam, and in our exam review, we summarized our course learning outcomes, which I've pasted onto this sheet. We've said that in this course, we're going to analyze, derive operating principles, and sketch transient voltage and current waveforms for common power electronic circuits. And this included the DC-DC, DC-AC, and AC-DC converters. So far, we've covered DC-DC and AC-DC converters. So the DC-DC converters were introduced using the single-pole double-throw switching primitive, while the AC to DC converters were the rectifiers we talked about in the first weeks. We've also spent a lot of time discussing how we dimension and select key components for these circuits in order to meet a design specification. And finally, we've noted that we haven't yet discussed DC to AC converters or the basic control steps for regulation of power electronic circuits. This lecture is going to tie in DC to AC converters or inverters. Our next unit that we'll be entering into is going to talk about the basic control steps for designing closed loop regulation. So in this video, we're specifically going to be talking about the general topology of an inverter and a rectifier. And an inverter is a circuit that's able to convert DC to AC, while the rectifier is a circuit that converts AC to DC. And as we've been discussing lately, we consider, for switch mode electronics, we consider the primitive circuit to be a single pole double throw converter. So we've been sketching this converter over and over again, where we define a throw voltage and a pole voltage. And we've noticed that the average of our pole voltage is going to be equal to something that is less than our throw voltage. So that is, this circuit is a voltage divider in a sense. Our instantaneous pole voltage is either equal to our throw voltage or equal to zero. And so by choosing how frequently we connect the pole to the top throw, we're able to determine what fraction of the throw voltage appears at our pole. So if our throw voltage is 2,000 volts, our pole voltage can be anywhere between 0 to 2,000 volts. But if we want to make an inverter, that is a DC to AC converter, we need to get to negative voltage so far. So right now, our voltage can be anywhere between 0 and our throw voltage, but we want to be able to go to our negative quadrant as well. So we want to be able to go from our throw voltage down to 0 and down to the negative of our throw voltage. So how are we going to do that? Well, it turns out that we can play a little bit of a trick here. We can connect our load between two single pole double throw converters. So if we draw it like this, we now notice that we have two voltages we can control. We can control the pole voltage on the left side, which I'm now going to put an L next to it. And we can control the pole voltage on the right side, and I'll put an R next to it, independently of each other. So that is, we can pick the equivalent duty ratio of our left side to be one value, but the equivalent duty ratio of our right side to be a different value. And this allows us to apply a voltage across our load that varies between our positive throw voltage and our negative throw voltage. So for example, if our throw voltage was, let's say, 100 volts. At one instant of time, we could create an average pole voltage on the left side of 90 volts, and an average pole voltage on our right side of 10 volts, and you'd say that this translates to an output voltage of 80 volts. Now suppose that at a later instant of time, we are creating an average pole voltage on our left side of 10 volts and an average pole voltage on our right side of 90 volts, which translates to our output voltage being negative 80 volts. So you can see that we're now able to create a positive or a negative voltage across our load. Notice that our load is not being referenced to the negative rail of our converter. Instead, we're taking the load as being referenced across its terminals, and we've connected the terminals to the inductor of each pole. So we have our inductors for current stiffness sources, and then we connect the pole, or we connect the load between the two inductors. So the name for a single pole double throw converter is a half bridge. And when you consider this entire circuit together, you say that it is a full bridge or a single phase converter. And this also goes by H-bridge for short because it looks like an H. So again, when you have these two half bridges together on either side of a load, you call it a full bridge circuit or an H-bridge. And this topology lets you apply bidirectional pole voltages. Your load can go between the positive throw voltage and the negative throw voltage by changing the average pole voltage on each side of the load. Let's now talk about the semiconductor realization of this. And to get there, we need to talk about the direction of the current flow. If this is truly an inverter, then we say that our current has to be able to flow both ways because it's AC. So IP is equal to AC. And we've noticed that, as we've talked about previously, our throw voltage has to be a stiff DC source. So we've added these voltage stiffeners, the capacitors. And so far, we've been talking about the source being on the throw side and the load being in the middle. But instead, there's no reason for it to be this way. Power flow can be either direction. So this could be your load out here, and in which case you have a source inside. But the point is that whatever is connected across your throw has to be DC. So if you have it, as I've labeled in blue, where you have a load across your throw and the source in the middle, so if the source is in here but the load is out here, that is a rectifier. And if you have the source being across the throw and the load being in the center, then you're operating as an inverter. Okay, so now let's talk about the semiconductor realization. We've said that our pole current is bidirectional and our throw voltage is always positive. And if you go back to our lecture on how to realize the semiconductors for this, you'll see it looks something like this. So notice that first I've sketched the semiconductor realization for unidirectional current flow, and then in parallel with it, I will sketch the semiconductor realization for bidirectional current flow. And this is the basic realization for a full bridge, where your current can take either direction. And this also is similar to our previous discussion about the active-active realization of the switching power pole. Now both of our switching power poles have the active-active realization, that is, we have active devices on either side. If we were to remove, and again noting that we have a source out here and a load in here, if we're talking about inverter operation, or we have a load out here and a source out here for talking about rectifier operation. So again, the rectifier operation has the source in the center, and now our MOSFETs are operated in a way that allows us to rectify the voltage to our load. And you'll notice at first that this seems in contradiction to what we talked about in the first week of the class, where we had no active devices, we had purely passive devices. However, if you were to erase these MOSFETs, you're left with the single phase full bridge converter that we talked about in the first week of the class. So that is to say that if you take away the transistors, it becomes a passive rectifier. And the passive rectifier you cannot control. It turns on and off based on the source voltage and the load voltage values. So whenever your source voltage exceeds your VDC equivalent, your diodes turn on. Whereas if you were to use a realization with the active MOSFETs here, you can select when your devices will turn on and off. So briefly, I want to highlight what this looks like in practice. In my group, we've developed a half bridge board, as I've shown here, And if we look at this board, let's parse it out. So we've got a MOSFET here attached to a heat sink, another MOSFET here attached to a heat sink. And these are, in fact, actually silicon carbide MOSFETs. And this board simply looks like this, where this capacitor out here is shown right here. So each of the MOSFETs that I circled consists of a body diode, as well as the active MOSFET device. And so this entire board looks like a single pole double throw switch in the active-active realization. And right here on the circuit board is our gate driver circuitry. This end of the board and this end of the board form the connections to the bus bars. So I have actually got this backwards right now, but this end at the bottom here is this bus bar up here. This end at the top up here is this bus bar down here. And this whole thing is in fact our throw voltage. So if you take a bunch of these half bridge boards together and you connect them across bus bars, you get a power electronic converter. So this would be a negative bus bar, and this could be our positive bus bar. And you have capacitors that are providing the voltage stiffness for the throw. So here you can see the individual capacitors on each board, and then we provide a large bulk capacitor out on the ends here. So in summary, the single pole double throw primitive that we've been developing recently is the fundamental building block for all of our circuit topologies. It's a fundamental building block of the DC, of the DC-DC converter, of the DC-AC converter, and the AC to DC converter. Next in this class, we're going to take a segue into control theory and talk about closed loop regulation of power electronic circuits. After that, we're going to loop back and talk in more detail about the components of converters. We're going to talk about transformer and inductor design, and then get more into DC to AC converters and the applications that they are used for.